Now that's all. I opened up the letter and the letter read,
"To whoever receives this letter, my name is Richard Mejia. I'm an archaeologist. And many years ago, my friends and I were digging, searching for a treasure, a known treasure in the mountains of Saratoga. We found this treasure. It was beautiful. We tried to divide it up so each of my archaeological friends could have a piece. And we would be rich beyond our wildest dreams, but no matter what we could do, the treasure, it would not break. We started arguing over the treasure. And it got to the point where we were very, very angry with each other, and we decided we can't do this. We have to come up with a good strategy. What we decided to do is we were going to take the treasure and hike it up the mountains of Saratoga. We were going to take the treasure and embed it into a boulder. We were going to cement the treasure inside the boulder. And then whichever one of us lived the longest, the last one to remain alive, could have the treasure for themselves. If you received this letter, that treasure could possibly be yours."
"Mine?"
"Yes, yours."
"Whoa."
"Here's what you must do. You must hike up the mountains into Saratoga. When you get up into the mountains, you're going to find a river, a creek, called the Sacred Pool. Buried down in one of the pools is a treasure in and of itself, a small ruby. You need to get that ruby. Once you get that ruby, you need to hike up further into the mountains of Saratoga until you find the wandering tree. When you find the wandering tree, stand with your back to the tree. Walk exactly 10 paces due south. There you will find the boulder. Once you find the boulder, find a redwood branch that is 6 feet tall. Face due east. Walk 32 steps away from the boulder. Tie the red ruby on top of the branch. And as the sun rises behind the mountains to the east, the treasure will be revealed to you, and it shall be yours."
"This is awesome!" "Oh man, I was so excited. I called my best friend. I called my friend, TJ. He's really cool because he likes Star Wars. He got Scooby and cool. I called my friend Randy because he's really smart. I called my friend Gordon because he's a friend to the end. Totally cool. I called my friend Chuck because he's a good athlete. I assembled my team, but there was one person missing. And that was a new kid in the neighborhood. He just moved in like a couple days ago. I thought, he's new, you know, we gotta invite him, make him feel like one of the guys, you know. His name was Yenrab, and he was really nice, but he couldn't really talk. I don't know why. I don't know if his tongue was broken or something, but he was just quiet. Maybe he was just super shy, I don't know. So I told my friends, meet me in downtown Saratoga, and bring all the money you got. So we made our way to downtown Saratoga. My friend Gordon brought $7.22. Chuck brought $9. Randy brought $5.50. TJ, he brought a comb. A button, and one piece of gum. Yenrab brought like $3.75. I brought a nickel. And we decided to buy some supplies. We figured this is going to be an overnight trip, so we should bring something for lunch, something for dinner, and brekkie fast, and all that stuff. So we brought a can of SpaghettiOs. We bought a marshmallow. We bought some bologna.
Obi-Wan bologna. Obi-Wan bologna.
Want to see a snack now? hive. And we started our journey up the mountains of Saramatoga. And we found the beginning of the creek. And we knew if we followed the creek up the mountains of Saramatoga, we had to encounter the sacred pools. As we hiked farther and farther up, we kept seeing glimpses of what could be the sacred pools, but something called the sacred pools has to look beautiful. And everything we saw was nice, but not quite. And there it was. As we turned the corner, we saw the most beautiful collection of pools of water. It had to be. Now this was an important moment for us. For as we dove down into each of the sacred pools and dug around, if one of us were to find the ruby, then it would be true. The treasure would be out there somewhere. Chuck was the first person to dive into the water. He went down and dug as far as he could. But he couldn't breathe a whole lot underwater. Nobody can. He splashed up in the water. Randy dove in. Dug. Gone out of the water. Gordon dove down in. And this happened time and time again. Each of us taking our own turn down into the Wawa. And then finally, Chuck splashed up out of the water. And in his hand was the red ruby. It's awesome! Because now it's true. And that red ruby, it would make us richer beyond our wildest dreams in of itself. But there was a bigger treasure out there for us to find. But the sun was slowly setting behind the mountains to the west, and it was getting time to dark. And although we love to do night hikes, we thought we better wait. It would be safer that way. So we set up camp. We unrolled our sleeping bags. We made a little fire. We cooked the pescadillos. We didn't want the bologna. And as we sat around the campfire, we decided what would be cool around the campfire out in the middle of the woods but some scary stories, right? Well, my friend TJ, he was like, yo, Scoob, I got a great scary story. I was like, yeah, It's a scary story my grandpapa told me a long time ago. Is it really scary, TJ? Oh, yeah, it's super scary. And the story he told went like this.
Once upon a time, I had myself a little dream. I dreamed that I was at the mall. I was walking around with my family. I turned to tell my dear sweet wife Lois something, and they were gone. Yeah, that was weird. I searched around for my family, but I couldn't find them. Well, then I felt something tap me on the shoulder. And again, I thought it was my dear sweet wife Lois, and as I turned around, it was not Lois, no. There, standing behind me, was a giant coffin. It had arms. It had legs. And I thought, this must mean I'm going to die. I do not want to die. So I ran away from the coffin as fast as I could, and to my surprise, the coffin started chasing after me. I had to find me a really good place to hide. So I ducked inside a record store. I hid behind one of the aisles. I could hear the coffin clippity-cloppity walking its way towards me. I looked around to see what I could defend myself with, and all I had around me were a bunch of CDs. So I grabbed as many as I could. Justin Bieber to the rescue! All the CDs started flying and smashing up upon the coffin. But no matter what I did, the coffin wouldn't stop. No, it wouldn't stop. But I managed to distract it long enough so I could slip right past it. As I slipped right past the coffin, I started running around trying to find another great place to hide. And I found me an old antique store. There were signs everywhere saying, you break it, you pay for it. I carefully picked up an old antique, and I smashed it on the ground. That's just a dream, I don't have to pay for nothing. But the coffin walked in. Then I started walking ever closer to the steel. I was like, oh no, what am I gonna do? I grabbed as many antiques as I could, started going down the coffin. But no matter what I did, the coffin wouldn't stop again. It would not stop. But I managed to distract it long enough. Yeah, long enough to slip right past it. This happened time and time again, in one store, out the other. No matter what I do, the coffin won't stop. No, it wouldn't stop. And I thought, wait a minute. Maybe this means I'm going to die in the mall. Yeah. Maybe if I leave the mall, the coffin would finally stop. Maybe, just me. Well, I started heading towards the front doors of the mall. I pushed the doors open. And I made my way outside, and I thought, finally. I mean, the sky was as blue as I'd ever seen it. The birds were chirping a happy, happy tune. And I thought, finally. Finally. The coffin burst out the door behind me. I had to find me a better place to hide. A safe place to hide. And the safest place in town, Safeway. I made my way over to Safeway. I stepped on the magic floor that makes the doors open. I made my way inside and I hid behind one of the aisles. I could hear the doors open. I could hear the clicking company footsteps of the coffin walking that way. What was I gonna do? I looked around to see what aisle I was in. Where could I defend myself with? And I was in the medicine aisle. I grabbed some toothpaste. I grabbed some deodorant. The coffin jumped around the corner. Take this, stinky boy! But the coffin wouldn't stop. No. I grabbed some aspirin. I'll give you a headache! The coffin wouldn't stop. I grabbed some Pepto-Bismol. Now you're all pink. But no matter what I did, the coffin wouldn't stop. There's only one thing left to do. The only thing left to defend myself with was a bag of cough drops. I grabbed the bag of cough drops. I opened up one of the little packages and I ate the cough drop. And when I ate the cough drop, the coffin stopped.
Is that supposed to be some kind of joke, TJ? TJ looked at me and was like, I mean, that's not a scary story. That was a joke the whole time. Come on, TJ. That wasn't scary at all. TJ looked at me and said, oh, yeah? You have a story that's scarier than that? I looked at him and said, oh, yeah. And I told him a scary story, all right. A story of my fourth birthday party. Yeah, I know. How Barney showed up and terrorized me. How he chased me all over Santa Cruz. Of our epic food fight battle. How we destroyed the one telepower atop a mouse snapper lever. And my friends were so scared by the scary tale that they cried themselves to sleep. Well, we woke up at about 4:30 the next morning. The sun was slowly starting to rise behind the mountains to the east. We had to find this wandering tree, and we had to find it quick. We made our way up the creek. But what would this wandering tree look like? Such a strange riddle. And then we saw it. A giant tree standing alone in a meadow. And as the wind blew, it looked like it was walking back and forth. It's the wandering tree. We made our way over. We walked 10 paces due south, and there was the boulder. We found a redwood branch that was 6 feet tall. We tied the red ruby atop it and walked exactly 32 paces to the east. And we waited. We waited for the sun to rise, and as the sun rose above the mountains to the east, a very faint beam of sunlight hit the red ruby, and it acted like a laser, for a pink light made its way through the ruby, and it hit the boulder, and at first, nothing really happened. It just turned the boulder kind of a pinkish color. But as the sun got higher, that beam became stronger! And sparks started to fly off the boulder. Bits and pieces of the boulder started to fly off. It's working. The treasure's buried inside, and it will be ours. As the beam got stronger, bigger pieces of boulder started flying off. It started getting quite dangerous. There were smokes, fires. There's Katie! It was so bright, it was so difficult to see through the smoke and the fire. I was crazy! And then, as we looked into the fire, Yenra, my good friend, the new kid from around the corner, he's standing over by the boulder! And you could see the treasure. It was there, glistening and shining. He had his hands wrapped around it. He was trying to pull it out. We're like, no, Yenra, what are you doing? Just wait a few more minutes, it'll be out soon. You're crazy! My friend Gordon and Chuck, they ran over to try to save Yenrab. But as soon as they got over to Yenrab, Yenrab just pushed them back and they go fly through the forest. Woohoo! Yippee! What are you doing? How do they learn how to fly? That's crazy. Well, then TJ and Randy ran over. But same thing happened. Yenrab just pushed them away and they too go fly. Yum! That's messed up! I want to fly too! I was like, well, maybe they don't know how to fly. Maybe it's just that Yenrab's strong. He's strong. And then it hit me. Yenrab! Yenrab is Barney spelled backwards. I hope this isn't true, kid. But if you who I think you are, you better
you know who I am.
If Barney's ghost possessed this poor kid and was trying to get the treasure, it can't be a good thing. I ran over to try to tackle the kid off of the boulder. But as soon as I hit the kid, I totally bounce off! Because he's a little squishy. No, he's a lot squishy. And once again, I go fly across here. Woohoo! I smashed up against a redwood tree. The back of my head go cuckoo for cocoa butter. And as I slowly started to slide down the tree, the kid pulled the treasure from out of the boulder. It was purple, of course. It had beautiful green specks in it. And it was in the shape of a heart.
The purple heart of Barney's is mine.
And Barney's ghost left the poor kid.
I shall get my revenge.
And that's when I go my night. I wake up a couple hours later to see my friend TJ standing above me with a bucket of lava. What are you doing with a bucket of lava? TJ looked at me and said, you will not wake up, I pour water on you. That's messed up! Don't pour the water on me, I'm awake. And I was like, wait a minute, where's the kid? Where's the Enrab? They all pointed to the poor kid laying over by the boulder. We ran over. We tried to wake him up. We shook him. He wouldn't wake up. We tickled him. He wouldn't wake up. TJ tried to pick his nose. He's weird! Nothing would wake him up. I looked at TJ and said, TJ, go get the bucket of water. We stood over the poor kid and poured the water on him. you woke up. But dude, kid, are you okay? Where am I? Who are you guys? Look, you were possessed by Barney the dinosaur's ghost. And the kid threw up. I don't blame him because I would have too. We're like, kid, come on, man. Who are you? He looked at us and said, My name is Badger. And that's the first time that I've met my good old buddy Badger. He doesn't remember being possessed by the purple dinosaur. I wouldn't want to remember that either. But although we saved the poor kid, something that Barney said as I go fading into knockout land had me quite worried.
I'll get my revenge.
Which is the title of part 6, Barney's Revenge. Thank you very much.